Stuart, for the introduction. Yes, that's a bit of a strange talk. That's a gadget that we started to work on before the COVID, and we just finished developing it, and then the COVID struck. So we didn't get as much time to play with it as we wished for, but I think is a nice gadget if you like corrosion and corrosion testing. So the outline of today's talk is here, and essentially I want to explain why I think that varying the pH during corrosion testing is a good idea. Briefly talk about how people tend to control the pH normally, and why this method don't really work very well for what we aim to do. So we made a device that can control the pH of a cell electrochemically. So I'll explain you basically the construction of the device. We'll see if it works, and to some extent it does. To some extent there are things that need a bit of improvement, and then summary. So why we think that testing under variable pH is a good idea? Well, if you think about the problem of corrosion testing, when you have a product that gets sold worldwide or something that is applied to protect a moving vehicle, that situation will experience a lot of different environments. This can include wet and dry cycle, humidity, pollution, chloride, and so forth. But the way we normally conduct corrosion testing, both for academic purposes and for technological purposes, is that we select a few environments at best, and then this selection is relatively arbitrary, normally based on standard or based on previous experience, and then we assume that the performance in those limited environments give us some indication of the performance in real life. So it is clear that, ideally, in an ideal world, if we had unlimited resources, it would be much safer to carry on corrosion testing in a large variety of environments, in a large variety of conditions, and that would at least increase the confidence that what comes out from corrosion testing is actually fit for service. However, clearly, that would increase the time for testing, the cost for testing, and is not particularly entertaining to do. So we need to make choices. So if we wanted to change one environmental parameter that we inspected in terms of corrosion testing, I think that it would make sense to select the pH as a first. Why it would make sense to change the pH? Well, because corrosion, being an electrochemical process that involves the dissolution of metal and the reduction of oxygen or the evolution of hydrogen, always results in local formation of acidity nearby the anodic sites and alkalinity nearby the cathodic sites. As a result, even if we deploy a material in an environment which nominally is okay for that material, for example, if we deploy aluminium in neutral condition, on the local scale, we might have situations where the pH is significantly different. One example that we can see of what are the effects of the pH, if Howard could play the video of the Krevis freeze, is Krevis corrosion. Here we have a model Krevis that is generated with a glass on top of 2024 aluminum copper magnesium alloy. And we see that just the fact of placing the glass in front of the alloy to generate a Krevis generates all sorts of effects on the corroding surface. So we see darkening on the outside of the Krevis. That's because the outside of the Krevis becomes more alkaline, and that reveals the precipitation of copper product. We see that on the inside, the decrease in pH favors the development of hydrogen. So we have an additional cathodic reaction that develops inside the Krevis, and we can't see it very well from this picture, but we also see pinkish deposit of copper, which are associated to the fact that the copper that was contained in the alloy and has oxidized can then redeposit in the acidic condition. So this gives you an idea of how much the pH can change as a result of a corrosion process. Now, when we have a surface treatment, this is almost an accidental image that shows this point. So here we have the cross section of an aluminum alloy with an anodic layer on top. Let me see if I have a pointer. Yes. So you see, this picture was not taken with the specific purpose of revealing this effect, but essentially we have the alloy matrix, the anodic film, which is this line here, this residual film here, and then a lot of corrosion products on top. So the corrosion sites was somewhere here, and we see that the thickness of the remaining anodic oxide is increasing as we move further away from the corrosion site. That means that the pH variation associated to the corrosion site was aggressive to the film and therefore helped the deterioration in the proximity. So it is important to know how a surface treatment would react of a variation of pH, even though the nominal working pH may not change significantly. And of course, if you have any type of surface treatment, a coating or a conversion coating or whatever, you know, you can have always a situation where a corrosion site develops, and that will result in region with low pH and region with high pH, and the region and this formation of this region will expose the protective treatment to different pH. So hopefully I have convinced you that it may make sense to try and do corrosion testing by varying the pH. Let's see if we do it with a relatively sort of standard approach. So this is a situation where we wanted to compare the anti-corrosion performance of two types of anodic oxide films, one obtained in particular set of conditions, in particular a lower voltage, and the other one at a higher voltage. So instead of testing at one single pH value, in this, for example, pH 7, we have tested it in a spectrum of, in a range of pH. So from pH 3 to pH 11. Now you see, and we have also on the y-axis, we have the pH values, and on the x-axis, we have the time. So you see that if you do that, your confidence in the fact that the left treatment is better than the right treatment is pretty high, because you see that you have a much wider range of time and pHs where the material is resisting corrosion. Whereas in the right side, you can see that the corrosion appears at shorter time and in a more pH conditions. So that's good, but clearly that is not a practical approach, because we have moved from a situation where we are testing, you know, one specimen for a set time to where we have multiplied by 5 the number of testing. So that's really not something that is likely to be viable in practice. So what about if we were able to do something like this? If we were able to apply the equivalent of what we do with a potential dynamic polarization, if we did it with a pH sweep? And what if we could take electrochemical measurement, for example, the potential or the polarization resistance during each point of this pH sweep? So that's what we tried to do. How can we achieve that? Well, we can't easily do that with the usual way of controlling pH, which are, for example, using a buffer or using a flowing electrolyte. Because if we use a buffer, I mean, the advantage of the buffer is that pH is very stable, and even locally, we can be fairly confident that the buffer will counteract a change of pH. But if we try to sweep the pH over a certain range, the buffer is not very practical. And also in corrosion, the buffer is not good because we start to introduce other species, and to change the pH, we need to change the buffer. And that's that generates problem, because then the anions of the buffer and the cations will interact with the corrosion process and effectively make very difficult the interpretation of the results. So we can't do that. We could, in principle, have reservoirs of electrolyte that we pump, for example, a high pH and a low pH electrolyte. That can be done experimentally. However, if we imagine that we want to have something cheap and fast to sweep the pH, that's basically very painful. And the reason why it's painful is that because pH is a logarithmic scale. So you would need to have a pump that is at the same time extremely precise and can pump a lot of electrolyte depending on which point in the pH scale you are, or you could have multiple pumps. Very painful. We don't want to do that. So the principle that we tried to implement was this fairly simple idea that we can have an electrochemical cell which contains two inert electrodes in each side, and then the cell is separated by a porous material, so that the porous material allows the ionic movement between the left side and the right side of the cell, but prevents the macroscopic exchange of the solution. So clearly, if we have a situation like this, then we apply a potential that is higher than the potential required to split water, we end up developing oxygen on one electrode and developing hydrogen on the other electrode. Being oxygen and hydrogen evolution an anodic and cathodic reaction respectively, we end up with a situation where on the right side of the cell, we increase the pH, and on the left side of the cell, we decrease the pH. So we need to implement this from the practical point of view. So essentially, we generated this electronic board, where essentially we have two parts of the board. One is effectively a potentiostat, not particularly different from what you would have in a commercial potentiostat. And in the other part of the board is the part that does the pH control. So the idea is that the part that does the pH control has a pH probe connected to it, a stirrer, and then the two connections to the oxygen and hydrogen evolving electrode, such as essentially it measures the pH, makes an evaluation on which direction of potential should be applied and how much potential should be applied, applies the potential for a set time with the stirrer on to make the pH homogeneous, and then measure the pH again. And it keeps doing that iteratively until the target pH, reaches of the cell that you are interested in, reaches the target pH that you want. Once you are at this target pH, this analog interface disconnects physically all the electrodes to avoid the problem of interference, and this one comes into play, and the potentiostat start to measure things. So that's how it should work. We have then made a specific cell. So that's the implementation of the cell. This is 3D printed cell. Essentially, you see you have the two portion of the electrochemical cell. This is a separator where we can put the porous material inside, basically a plastic sponge. Then we have the housing for the stirrer, which is this one. And then we have a series of places where we can actually place the various electrodes and carry out all the measurements. So the whole thing assembly is like this, with the cell connected where we perform the experiment and the analog to digital part of the circuit that effectively controls the pH and measures the electrochemical response. So does it work? A little bit, yes. I would say yes. Not perfectly, but it doesn't. So this is an example of an applied pH triangular sine wave that has been applied for about 20,000 seconds. And you see that we can control quite precisely the pH from 7 to 10, back to 4, and we can cycle this several times. Of course, this was done while magnesium was corroding. So as magnesium corrodes quite fast. So we have that magnesium ions are injected into the solution. There is a bit of buffering effect, and then it loses a bit of linearity. So that's something to work on. But if you look at the individual transient here and here, we can see that we can obtain a quite an accurate control of the pH. So that's good news because in principle, the concept works, even not perfectly, but I think that's already an interesting gadget to play with. So what we can do now? Well, if you see at each of these transient, we can stop this pH transient, we can stop and perform an electrochemical measurement. So as an example, I'm going to show you some of the data that have been acquired at pH 7. So 7.1 will be the beginning, 7.2, 7.3. And we can, for example, take the potential or a measurement of linear polarization. So then we can automatically extract the key information, for example, the last value of potential or the slope of these curves that give us the linear polarization, and plot them later on, as I will show, to make some sort of conclusion. Here, I'm looking at the corrosion of magnesium, pure magnesium in 3.5% sodium chloride. So these are the sort of things that we see at pH 7. These are similar transient measured at pH 10. And these are similar transient measured at pH 4. And of course, we also have the not identical, similar situation measured at every intermediate interval. So what comes out of this type of measurement in the case of magnesium? Well, one thing that comes out is something like this. So a graph where we can have the pH as a function of time, then we have the polarization resistance, and then we have the potential. So we can already notice that these are two nominally identical experiments with that they are not identical because the reproducibility of magnesium corrosion is not great. But if you look qualitatively at the behavior, you see that the pH wave, the pH signal is not too, it is relatively reproducible. Then we have this interesting behavior where at the beginning, the corrosion of magnesium does not appear to depend on the pH. And then after a while, we see that there is a response, there is a, there is a sort of correlation between what we observe both in terms of potential here and what we observe in terms of polarization resistance and the applied pH. What we can also do, which I think, I mean, if you like corrosion is quite cool, is to produce this type of cubes where we can have the polarization resistance as a function of pH or the potential as a function of pH. So as we saw in the previous curve, at the very beginning, there is no much correlation between the value of polarization resistance and the pH, but the correlation becomes stronger later on. And a similar observation can be done for the potential. So if we try, as just an example, to relate those findings with what we know about the corrosion of magnesium, essentially, we know that is quite a complicated phenomenon. Here, we have the typical time evolution of a magnesium corroding surface. You see that it starts quite shiny. Then we have the nucleation of these dark areas. And then this dark area progressively propagate until the whole surface is covered. Now, if you take a cross section and image the cross section in situ while you have the corrosion of magnesium, you will see that on the shiny area, you have a small number of hydrogen bubbles that are stable. Those are probably located on the cathodic intermetallic, and these are like an occasionally formed and occasionally formed floating away. Then we have on the black area, a lot of hydrogen bubbles that are formed. And these are formed, I would say, at medium rate. But then at the corrosion front, where is the interface between this black and shiny area, we have this hydrogen stream, which is virtually a continuous stream of hydrogen that is generated at the corrosion front. So the key point is that this hydrogen stream is only observed during the first pass of corrosion, because it's associated to the conversion of the initially present air-formed film that gives the shiny appearance to the residual film of corrosion product after the corrosion has passed. So this part is likely to have a very low impedance compared to this part here and this part here, and is also relatively extended, so it will probably dominate the response during the early stages, and therefore is not substantially affected by the pH. But then once the whole shiny area is disappeared and everything is determined by the behavior of the residual corrosion product, then it is possible that this corrosion product will react to a pH change, and therefore we see those fluctuations. So that was just an example, and to some extent, you know, an example where we looked at a fairly fundamental case. But in principle, we proved the concept that we could perform the corrosion testing under variable pH with a setup that at the end of the day is relatively simple and cheap to make. So what are the actual issues that remain and we need to look at? Well, I think one of the issues is that it evolves a little bit of chlorine when we try to make oxygen. So that requires to work a little bit on the geometry of the electrodes, make them larger and improve the potential control from the software side, such as we try to limit as much as possible the evolution of chloride, because that would add oxidizing species to that compartment. So we want to improve that by changing the electrode material, changing the size of the electrode and the control algorithm. An interesting thing to do could be to use this in a chloride-free environment and see what happens on a variety of material. And once we have it up and running and reliably capable of applying a well-defined triangular wave, if it is any use to do practical corrosion testing, for example, on surface treatments or maybe even organic coating. So that concludes. I'd like to acknowledge Lightform for the funding of this project and you for your attention. Thank you very much.
So good characteristic of a good talker is that they answer the question you have in your mind in the last slide. Thank you. That was chlorine evolution was the one I had.
I had a different one, and that was oxygen evolution. Because basically, as well as changing the pH, you're changing the redox potential of your solution from strongly oxidizing to strongly reducing as you go from the oxygen reaction to the hydrogen evolution. This is inevitably coupled with the change in pH, I would guess, which must be a fundamental limitation of this approach.
Yes, I would tend to agree with. I do agree with you. I think that the way we started this was: can we have something that applies a pH sweep easily? No? Yeah. Then, of course, when you start, you discover that it's not that easy as you thought before, and then when you try it, you realize that there are all these sort of issues. But in principle, if you use it as a practical tool, I think that what you are saying is. Yes, it is an issue, but you know, when you have stuff that is actually rusting with a coating on or an anodic layer on, and you need an indication of the performance, I think you can live with that. If you need to make a fine, you know, fundamental discussion on how metal behaves as a function of pH, I entirely agree that we have this issue.
I'm just wondering to myself whether you could decouple those two things by degassing the solution or passing controlled gas through the anode and cathode spaces. And have a sort of perforated separator, which will allow the pH variations to diffuse into the specimen compartment without actually getting the gas in there so much.
I think that's a possibility. I think it could. I mean, now that you say it could also be a good idea to bubble air just below the electrode that is evolving the pH, and that would. You know, reduce a bit the effect you point out and maintain the agitation. So that's a good idea, yes.
If I can just also mention one piece of evidence from a long time ago, Mervyn Turner, who was running the corrosion group at ICI a number of years ago, told the story of a plant where they were making ammonium nitrate. Now, normally ammonium nitrate is a byproduct, but they were making it because they needed more than they were producing. And they did it by reacting ammonia and nitric acid. And sometimes it caused very rapid corrosion of stainless steel, other times it didn't. And they concluded eventually that that was because if you allowed the ammonia and the nitric acid to get pumped in at different times, you cycled the pH. And that rapidly removes the corrosion product because the corrosion product in ammonia is one thing, iron oxides, and in nitric acids, it's chromium oxides, or maybe the other way around. I can't even remember
now.
I see. But that's a more extreme case, but it is an interesting one.
Thank you.